Hi everyone. While we are all trying to keep ourselves safe and secure, the government has tried doing its bit to keep the businesses safe by issuing this IBC Amendment Ordinance 2020. We had been talking about it, our FM announced certain measures. This particular ordinance formalizes some of those measures. I'm saying some of those measures because RFM also announced regarding some special measures to be undertaken for MSMEs under IBC. But those measures do not form a part of this ordinance. This ordinance simply talks about suspension of IBC filings and some relaxations from wrongful trading provisions. I'll be doing a quick analysis of the ordinance today, as the language of ordinance is seemingly creating confusion in certain areas. And there might be certain cribbing questions also to which we might not be having a ready answer. But yes, we'll try to put the questions forward. So first, let us have a look at how there were relaxations in tranches. As we know, there was first the relaxation was NCIRP regulations, after which NCLAT came up with the exclusion order by which the CIRP period was defined or determined to exclude the lockdown period. Then there were amendments in the liquidation regulations. Then our FM made certain announcements regarding a special insolvency framework for MSMEs, suspension of fresh filings for 1 year. There was a confusion. Some of us thought that the suspension would be a blanket ban on all kind of fresh filings, whether or not the default takes place during this particular unprecedented situation. But this ordinance is quite clear on that regard. As I already said, that this ordinance includes the one part of it, that is the suspension part, but not the special insolvency framework part for MSMEs. Instead, a very important provision is being included in this ordinance, which pertains to wrongful trading that I'll be taking up later in due course. Meanwhile, we should not forget that there had been various other measures in place. For example, RBI moratorium. There had been revisions in MSMEs. These all should be taken as a part and parcel of the entire system, of a single system. And any view which we take should be formed holistically by taking into picture the entire scenario, all the measures taken together. So coming to what the ordinance says, as I said, there are two aspects. One is insertion of section 10A. The second is insertion of section 66.3. I'll first talk about insertion of section 10A. So this section 10A is providing relaxation for defaults occurring during the disruption period. I'll call it disruption period for the sake of brevity. The term has not been used by the ordinance. Disruption period starts from 25th March 2020, that is when the lockdown started, and it continues for a period of 6 months. The government has the power to notify a further period which should not exceed 1 year from 25th March. So the total disruption period is starting from 25th March and ending at the end of 6 months or 1 year, as the case may be. So any default which occurs during this disruption period is insulated. No form of IBC filing can be done against this particular default ever. So there are certain points which should be noted here. First point is that the ban is a forever ban. If, for example, if I have committed a default during this disruption period, no creditor will ever be able to file an application against me. Now, there is a rider here. I'd like to discuss that. I'd like to deliberate upon that in detail. But just take the points first. So first point is there is a forever ban. Second is the suspension is umbrella suspension. umbrella suspension, as in there can be no filings under Section 7, that is, no financial creditor can proceed against me. There can be no filing under Section 9, that is, no operational creditor can proceed against me. And there can be no application under Section 10(2), which means that irrespective of whether I am an MSME or a non-MSME, large corporate, whosoever I am, I will not be able to initiate self-filing under Section 10. So as is obvious, the abatement, the exemption, the protection, whatever we may call it, is not available for defaults that occurred prior to 25th March. It is obvious. See, if I am talking about giving relaxations to people who are to corporate businesses which came in stress due to this COVID situation, they cannot claim relaxation for defaults that occurred prior to the COVID situation. Those kind of defaults were in ordinary course of business. That I cannot say that the default took place because you were stressed because of COVID. So this particular ordinance deals exclusively with the problems which have arisen because of COVID. So it is very obvious that the ordinance provides no abatement to defaults that occurred prior to 25th March 2020. So insertion of Section 66(3) is again an important provision. I'll discuss that later. First, let us see this chart. So there can be four possible scenarios. So occurrence of default, if takes place before disruption period, there is no abatement. I said the reason is very, very obvious. Occurrence of default, if takes place after disruption period, there is no abatement again. So here I would like to call the disruption period a cure period also. This disruption period is to be used by businesses to cure any kind of stress that they might have been facing because of COVID. So say if during the disruption period, the business is being able to cure the default which happened during the disruption period, the abatement is definite. So no creditor can file an application against me. But say, what if the default continues after disruption period? This particular question has come into minds of all, and it's creating a lot of confusion. So there is uncertainty regarding it. But looking into the situations under which this particular ordinance has been issued and looking into the intent of law, we are of the view that if a particular debtor defaults during the disruption period, but the default continues after the disruption period, there is no abatement. I cannot claim protection for a continuing default. What is the end? What is the end of the relaxation? There must be some kind of deterrent, which should work against me. So for the cure period, during the cure period, if I am being able to cure the default, then it's okay. The abatement is available. If the default continues, I can say that if the default continues after a disruption period, the default has taken place after disruption period. So it should fall under category 4. And therefore, there should be no abatement available. There is another angle to it. Say, if I take a view that a continuing default will continue to have the protection of this ordinance, then what I am doing is I am incentivizing debtors to accelerate their defaults. Which means that if as a debtor, I knew that 1 year down the line, I might be entering into some kind of a default zone, I'll accelerate that event. I'll default now because then it becomes a safe harbor for me. No creditor will ever be able to come in a position to initiate an IBC proceeding against me. So that's what we have tried to interpret harmoniously the ordinance and the intent of the law here, and that's what our view is. But let's see if there is any kind of clarity on it later. Coming to next point, as I said, we should take a holistic view of the measures taken. So this ordinance, when we analyze, we see this ordinance may not be of much use in Section 7 cases, because most of the financial creditors, banks, etc., would have given the RBI moratorium, and most of the borrowers could have availed the same. So there's no question of a default there. And in cases where the borrowers have not availed the moratorium, it's obvious that they were in a position to meet their obligations. And therefore, this Section 7, this ordinance might not be very much relevant for Section 7 cases. But yes, when we see Section 9 cases, this ordinance surely tries to contain the war of businesses. That's what we feel. This particular aspect, coming to the next aspect regarding MSMEs, I say that the definition of MSMEs have been revised. So basically, they have increased the threshold. An MSME which has invested in plant and machinery up to 25 lakhs was a MSME earlier. Now the threshold has been increased to 1 crore, which means my base of MSME creditors as well as MSME debtors has increased. So when I analyze the situation, say I am a non-MSME business, I will try to, my obligation, I'll have more MSME creditors now. So my obligation to pay them timely is now wider. There is a larger base of creditors who I need to pay timely. Otherwise, I'll have to face the wrath of Section 16 of MSME. So on one side, operational creditors are in a dizzy. Yes, because instead of, even if they meet the threshold of, even if they are seeing that the default has crossed 1 crore, they cannot go and file an application. So as a debtor to an MSME creditor, I can be relieved of the fear of IBC proceedings and can try to delay the payments to MSME creditor. But again, as I said, this wrath of Section 16 persists and there is no relaxation from that section. So it's better that we pay on time to these MSMEs. Now coming to the second part of the ordinance, which is wrongful trading. It's a very, very important provision. I would say if this provision, sans this provision, the suspension of IBC filings could not have served the purpose which it was intended to do. So wrongful trading provisions basically deal with directors' liability to act fairly, to act diligently during the penultimate zone of insolvency. As a director, if I am seeing that my company is not doing well or is going to be in a zone of insolvency, my duty towards creditors intrude my duty towards shareholders. So I have to act more reasonably, more diligently. And if I don't do that, I can be vulnerable to wrongful trading provisions that is contained in Section 66.2. This particular Section 66.3 says that a resolution professional should not file an application for defaults covered under Section 66, for defaults covered under Section 66. I am of the view that this particular Section 66.3 is relevant only for the purpose of Section 66.2 and not for the purpose of Section 66.1, because 66.1 deals with fraudulent trading. If during this disruption period I continue to trade fraudulently against so as to defraud my creditors, I cannot claim protection under 66.3. There is no protection to fraud. There can be a protection for trading during this stress situation. I might be forced to act under stress circumstances, but that will not relieve me from fraudulent trading provisions. So that's what our view is. Second, a very important point here is when I am determining look back period for forfeit transactions, the preferential, undervalued, etc. transactions, should I exclude this disruption period from the look back period of 2 years? Say I've initiated insolvency proceedings against a debtor as on 1st March 2021. Now as a resolution, so now when the resolution professional is determining the perfect transactions, so how for what period of time should he look back? Should he exclude the disruption period? I think that it should not be the case. There are high risks associated to misutilization or abuse of such provisions, such relaxations. Therefore, the disruption period should be included in the look back period, and the resolution professional will also be looking and sifting through the transactions which have taken place during this period. There will be no exemptions, in my view. So coming to certain questions which have come into our mind, there are certain ambiguities. So will date of demand notice matter? Say I have served a demand notice on 24th March 2020. Now there is a waiting period of 10 days. So if the debtor commits a default, he does not respond to my demand notice and does neither raise a dispute. So can I go and file an application against him? No. I cannot, because default is demand notice is basically a chance to the debtor to pay back the money. It is not exactly an evidence of default. Now, another interesting area is regarding corporate guarantors and personal guarantors. So corporate guarantors can still be saved under this ordinance, because ultimately CIRP provisions apply to such corporate guarantors also. As a creditor, I won't be able to initiate insolvency proceedings against a corporate guarantor if I invoke the guarantee and the guarantor fails to pay. But there is no relaxation for personal guarantees. There is no relaxation for personal guarantors. But, you know, acting reasonably and equitably, I think the consideration should also go to personal guarantors in this regard. Another possible question is, what if the default occurred in tranches? As we can see the illustration here, rupees 75 lakhs of default occurred in January 2020 and rupees 35 lakhs of default occurred on 1st April 2020. So can application be filed that part of the default occurred in January 2020? So here our contention is that the threshold of default was raised to 1 crore. Application for 75 lakhs cannot be filed. And since the default has occurred after 25th March, it can avail the abatement provided in the ordinance. There is another possible issue, which is of limitation. So should we exclude the disruption period from determining the limitation period? If I do that, if I do not exclude the disruption period, then it would be prejudicial to creditors. Because see, during the disruption period, my right as a creditor was hampered. I could not go and make an IBC filing against the debtor who has defaulted. Therefore, appropriately, my limitation timeline should exclude this limitation period. That is what my view is. Hope this particular discussion was useful to you. We would be happy to have any inputs, feedback on this particular discussion. And for any queries, you can get back to us at resolution@vinodkothari.com. And do subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thank you.